Yep.
So our first panelist is Dr. Paul Liknaitzky, who's the Executive Officer of Prime Minister Australia. He also holds Research Fellow appointments at GC University and Odyssey House, Victoria. He's an Aussie in neuroscience and a PhD in psychology from the University of Melbourne. He's worked on mechanistic experimentation and intervention development within depression and addiction research, the clinical applications and therapeutic mechanisms of psychedelic-assisted treatments are central to Paul's interests. A large part of Paul's doctorate investigated how psychedelic treatments and other treatments that produce non-ordinary states of consciousness are able to alleviate depression. He has extensive knowledge of psychedelic research and therapy, and his work includes the development and investigation of best practice clinical protocols and implementation frameworks that optimize safety, effectiveness, and sustained positive outcomes. Please welcome Paul. Our next panelist is Fiona Henrich. She's worked in private practice in mental health for 7 years as a registered clinical psychologist and in mental health more broadly for over 10 years. She is a Jungian philosophy honours graduate under the guidance of prolific Jungian professor, writer and professor David Tacey. She has profound interest in transpersonal psychology, shamanism, and the ways in which realms of consciousness can be explained by mystical arts. She's currently a PhD doctoral candidate investigating dreaming and the role it plays in the treatment of trauma. She works from a holistic paradigm heavily influenced by transpersonal psychology principles. Aside from her formal 17 years of consciousness research in the academic arena, she's an intuitive counselor, empath, and has an interest in spirituality as it relates to the human journey and consciousness. Please welcome Fiona. So I guess we all just witnessed the young lady's journey. And I guess just starting with yourself, Paul, obviously neuroscience, the way psychedelics can work in with that, especially when it comes to affective disorders like depression and interdependence ideas as part of your, I guess, scope, as well as looking at the way psychedelic research around the world has been used therapeutically and gained some positive results. What did you notice about that journey the young woman went through? What did you notice about the treatment received and what really stood out for you?
Oh, well, I'm exhausted. I think the main impression I had is just how damn hard it is. This is, you know, a woman who seems like she had incredible support around her and, you know, obviously some struggles in her childhood, but a pretty good one. And, you know, and she went into these mushroom trips, which did something, but not enough. And then she went into these iboga trips and they barely got her through. You know, it looked like an incredibly dedicated team and center there that just kept going and going for as long as she needed it. I guess I just feel the enormity of the challenge for so many people who are addicted to that degree. In terms of, you know, therapeutic mechanisms that you referenced, well, I guess it wasn't easy to see what was going on for her a lot of the time. So there wasn't a great deal of view into her psychological subjective process a lot of the time. So it was hard to gauge exactly how that was happening for her. But clearly iboga's got some pretty powerful neurochemical mechanisms of action. And it looked like mushrooms were doing what mushrooms tend to do, but it wasn't clear exactly what was going on for her.
Yeah, we're all kind of exposed to kind of the surface behaviour or the snippets of it from time to time, but we really don't know what's going on in the brain. We don't have brain imaging going on constantly, do we? So we don't know all these structural changes going on and how that's relating to her subjective experiences. So, yeah, that's an interesting contrast you kind of mentioned there in terms of, you know, what's kind of going on, what we're aware of, what we see, what we don't see. Fiona, you've got a background, especially in transpersonal psychology, which is such a significant canon of research and literature over the last 100 or so years, especially relating to other aspects of what people can identify with beyond themselves, and that can play a really intrinsic part in their therapeutic journey, especially when their therapeutic journey is catalyzed by a psychedelic substance. What did you notice in that film? What was meaningful for you?
For me, it was a really touching and stimulating documentary. I was quite moved by Adrienne's experience. What I noticed quite significantly was the role that plant medicine has to play in therapeutic applications for addiction and depression, and how there's a divergence between modern Western psychopharmaceutical treatment and plant medicine. That divergence is quite a profound one. That's what I noticed.
Yeah, it was almost like there was this failed paradigm of just opioid replacement therapy. And it sounded like she was receiving some kind of therapy as well, talk therapy, but it wasn't very clear what she was getting out of that, was it really? And so there was this need for an alternative pathway. Was there anything that any of you noticed that you think might have happened differently or could have worked better for her if it was sort of structured into her treatment?
I think any clinical trial would need to have an assessment of her background history and family of origin before proceeding with the doses that they were using in the documentary. And I think that's the problem facing current applications of the use of psilocybin as a pharmaceutical. There needs to be regulatory practices involved and psychotherapeutic monitoring.
Yeah, absolutely, a thorough assessment to really understand what's going on here and what therefore we must treat and in what order and what protocols we can utilise to maximise the opportunity for the best possible therapeutic outcome. That's something that you've been working on locally, Paul. Do you have any comments on just the way you've been focusing on getting that sort of started locally with reference, I guess, to what you might have observed during that film?
Yeah, I mean, I guess clearly there's a need and a demand for alternative and plant medicine-based treatments for addiction and depression and anxiety, and people are often desperate and turn to the underground. It was interesting in this documentary how, you know, they had gone to the extent of initiating a documentary on it, and they had done their Googling, but that first mushroom trip was pretty underprepared for, it looked like. And I guess that's probably the common trajectory. So, you know, in a regulated clinical context, it would look entirely different. There would be, like you say, adequate assessment of the individual, and then the standard clinical protocols these days include a number of psychotherapy sessions prior, and then, you know, supported trip sessions, and the program varies in length. Here in Australia, we're really just beginning the process. There's been obviously, I think a lot of people in the audience would be aware of the last 15 years or so of research that's resurged overseas, mostly in the US and also in the UK. And tonight we saw a few of the people that have been leading the charge. So Australia has only just entered into the conversation. The first psychedelic trial kicks off in the next few months here in Melbourne, the St. Vincent's trial, which is using psilocybin, synthetic psilocybin, to treat depression and anxiety in people with a terminal illness. And we're also in the process now of beginning to develop therapeutic training protocols. A lot has been done over, you know, decades through the 50s and 60s, and that continued underground in the prohibition years, and then from about 2005 there's been quite a substantial resurgence. Currently there are about 100 psychedelic trials that are just recently completed or active at the moment all over the world, and Australia now has one kicking off in the next few months, and we're planning subsequent trials here. Hopefully, in the next few years, there'll be many. But the challenge is quite wide. There are the challenges of adequate data. So currently, the gold standard in adequate data hasn't come through. That's called phase three clinical trials. Two large phase three clinical trials kick off. Well, one's just kicked off and the other one in the next few months overseas. So probably a couple of years now until we'll see the chance of regulating psilocybin and MDMA as prescription medicines. But they are, there's an enormous amount of work we need to do in order to prepare both clinicians and people who may participate in this treatment for it to work well. It's entirely different to anything else we've got.
Well, in order to, for it to be legalised, there's a lot of underground psychotherapists operating across the country that are using these for therapeutic application.
Yeah, absolutely.
So then it's about bringing it into the legal domain of clinical protocols, obviously, and so people don't have to go underground and, you know,
correct,
under the more riskier conditions, potentially.
That's not to say that necessarily it'll be a more safer application. We're not sure of the misuse of psychedelics as a pharmaceutical yet. We simply don't have any data.
Yeah, true. So now we'll open up to you, the audience. If you hold up your hand, I'll come round and you can ask a question to our panelists. Over here. You want to?
Thank you, Cam. I actually wanted to get an opinion from all of you on this, and I don't know if other people felt this in watching the film, but as was this at the start of the movie, it felt to me like the people doing the documentary were being maybe a little bit pushy with the idea that maybe you can solve these problems with psychedelics. And I say that because, so I'm the president of the Psychedelic Society. I see a lot of the things that come through our Facebook and our emails. And as you said, Paul, there's a lot of people that are desperate, looking desperately for solutions. And I understand that, but at the same time, I worry that in times of desperation that people might end up just going for something that there's not clear answers for, or pushing themselves for something that really doesn't help. I mean, it looked like at the end, because they did have that whole, you know, follow-up, that's what I was going to ask before the end happened and they had a big follow-up. But I guess I wanted some comments from you guys on how you felt about the ethics of how it was approached in the first place. I mean, no, of course, these guys aren't doctors, they're not psychologists, they're not, you know, they're documentary makers. They were looking for a story, first and foremost. And they got a good story, but I just felt like, I don't know, some strange ethical things. So just wanted some comment on that.
Yeah, my simple answer would be, I wouldn't advise going underground, but I totally understand it. And in that case, I mean, this woman is clearly saying she doesn't expect to live very long. And they could have done their research, you know, a bit better. But in the end, they got it to somewhere that was pretty effective.
Ethically, a psychotherapist would ask for informed consent before any kind of procedure would take place that involves the application of psilocybin. So that would be advisable even in the underground setting, and as far as I know, that's taking place.
But just to add to that, I also feel like, you know, you're right, that there's this kind of, as we see this new wave of research and remarkable results coming out of the clinical trials, I think there is a kind of panacea mentality that has crept in, for sure. And as you could see with her, it really took a lot more than just getting psychedelics into her bloodstream that did it in the end. And I think any simplistic ideas that you just have to go and, you know, consume psychedelics or meet Mother Eyre and all your problems will be solved, I think is delusional in general. I'm sure she probably will need to continue to do work for the rest of her life to keep the wolves at bay.
Ethically, any recreational use doesn't tend to lead to lasting results. There needs to be psychotherapy as an adjunct to the psilocybin use.
Yes, and just to reinforce that, these are adjuncts, these are catalysts that can, the right conditions, surface content that you can work with meaningfully and then integrate therapeutically, which could mean changing the way you react to all kinds of different things, other people, The way you react to distress, this woman had a low threshold of distress tolerance, therefore she learned using painkillers were the way she copes with that. Unfortunately, that was a maladaptive method of coping, so she had to learn through the therapeutic process a more adaptive way of coping with this distress that she would experience. And just to give a bit of clarification, iboga, that was about the neuropharmacology, essentially, allowing the withdrawal, the biological effects, to give her a bit of a baseline so that she could then work on the psychological aspect of, okay, what was the underlying mental health thing going on here that led to this pattern of opioid use to try and cope? So you need to work with the biological, restabilize your nervous system, and then you can look at, okay, now I'm okay to actually address the psychological. That might be the right kind of pattern, sort of order of approach with this kind of a young lady situation. Any other questions?
What advice would you give to people, for those who are thinking about taking on psychedelics to help their depression or anxiety? Where would they go? Where would they start?
So, as far as I'm aware, Arrowhead has a lot of information about microdosing and using different amounts of psilocybin for the treatment of depression and anxiety. Whilst, as a clinician, we're not supposed to recommend underground websites, it is one of the more informative ones that can assist with such things. Obviously, to be under the treatment of a trained psychotherapist or psychologist would be ideal, and there's a lot of information on the web that will give you precautionary measures and things like, if you've had a pre-existing history of psychosis, psilocybin isn't advisable, and that sort of thing. So always check with a mental health practitioner whether it's a suitable form of treatment.
And just maybe to add to that, that these classical psychedelics are not toxic. So so many of the concerns about risks associated with classical psychedelics are exactly wrong. There's very little indication that if you haven't got a predisposition to psychosis that you'll develop it. All the cases that have been investigated where people run in front of traffic or jump out of buildings thinking they can fly, usually these people have been quite unstable. However, these are powerful substances and there are some powerful risks, and it's really worthwhile paying a lot of attention to setting and cast, as these guys mentioned. So the state you go into the trip with, the environment and the people that you're with, and if you can take the time to find the right people to help you through it, that helps a lot, but that can take time.
If you can find a shamanic guide or a spiritual counsellor or someone who's trained in facilitating these kinds of journeys, then go for it. Don't do it alone, basically.
You don't take safety for granted ever when it comes to these things. It needs to be cultivated from the ground up, and it should never be something that sort of trivialises and, I think things will work out. It's not about that. It's about actually really feeling on all different levels and feeling comfortable to talk about it very openly of what safety might mean for you or the people that you know who might be interested in these pursuits in the right, safe and well-educated domains. Any other questions? We've got a couple, two or three more minutes.
Thank you. Is the safety of iboga well understood in terms of how different people might process it? And also, is the way that iboga, the mechanism of action of iboga, understood at all?
So, I don't know enough about iboga to answer that question fully. I believe the safety profile of iboga is not fully understood, and it's certainly not remotely as safe as the classical psychedelics like psilocybin and LSD and the like. People that are doing it underground are doing heart monitoring underground before they go in. There are all kinds of worrying effects. I actually just got an email from one of the lead iboga researchers in New Zealand last week who said, he's been researching ketamine and iboga for the last couple of years in a clinic in Dunedin, and he said, look, I'm concerned about the safety profile of iboga in general. Not sure if this is going to work, you know.
And just to add to that a bit, it can have some cardiovascular risks to it. It's a very extended experience. It's not a classic psychedelic experience like mushrooms. It's 24 hours plus ordeal, and it needs to be medically supervised. There are some medically supervised supervising clinics in Mexico that you can go to, and there's ECG monitoring, so any cardiac incidents that occur can actually be treated medically on site. So it does require medical monitoring. It's not something to go easy on. It is originally from Western African shamanic practices, but we've got a different concept of safety perhaps than the approach to an ordeal kind of a thing. Fiona?
And there's a massive difference between a shaman using a plant medicine versus an ordinary individual using a recreational substance. So in terms of safety, there's also the psychological effects that need to be taken into account.
And so that nurturing environment has to be maintained the whole time, and that's a lot of work, you know, and it is good to have, you know, a female there, when there's a female there, because they need to be taken care of by the right kind of energy, and that could require a female, because that whole dynamic is all plays into a therapeutic process, and people need to be felt, need to feel like they're being taken care of throughout that very long, arduous journey. You know, it's not easy healing, and it isn't easy healing with iboga, just like it isn't with conventional methods. Do we have any up the back, maybe? Got a few more minutes.
They're mentioning in the film combining traditional Western medicines and plant-based medicines. What would you say Adrienne's impression was for combining those, and what are some of your impressions of the combination of those two for therapy in the future?
There's certainly drug interactions between Western pharmaceuticals and plant medicines, and a lot of the drug interactions are not well understood or fully understood. For example, if you take MDMA and you're on SSRIs, you can elicit serotonin syndrome, so there's a lot of health risks in terms of the drug interactions. But I think from the film, Adrienne made a really interesting case about how the psychopharmaceuticals and the plant medicines were at loggerheads. I think there's a long, long way to go in the clinical research before we find a bridge that crosses both sides.
Maybe one more quick question.
I'm just really curious there, you speaking about that loggerhead situation and perhaps other options. For example, I work with IRES, which is a amazing practice based on the ancient tantric yoga nidra knowledge and system. And it came to me in watching the film that perhaps, you know, that intention setting, that embedding into the subconscious, rewiring, perhaps resetting some of those anxiety-loaded systems mentally and emotionally may have gone a long way into smoothing some of the results, perhaps some of the responses during the treatment. Are you aware of maybe or involved in combining these types of technologies?
Yes, I've actually just ordered a book on Kundalini Tantra and yoga techniques for psychiatric disorders. I'm getting myself knowledge up. I absolutely believe in the merging between East and West, 100%.
Maybe just to add to that, and relate to the previous question too, that while there isn't any, I don't know of any clear positive combination between typical psychiatric medication and classical psychedelics. I mean, typically, you know, if somebody comes into a psychedelic trial on antidepressants, they have to fully taper off them because it seems like they have oppositional effects, classical psychedelics and SSRIs, for example. But there's certainly a lot to be done in terms of combining psychedelic practice and other psychotherapies. So currently there are a number of trials kicking off that look like this. There's MDMA with prolonged exposure therapy. So prolonged exposure is one of the best therapies for trauma, and MDMA therapy has been showing remarkable results too. So they're combining these two, and possibly even using psycholytic doses, so slightly lower doses and using prolonged exposure during the trip session rather than a non-directive trip session. And the same goes for, you know, the recent amazing trial of Johns Hopkins that showed 80% quit rate with nicotine-dependent smokers after psilocybin. They used pretty long motivational interviewing psychotherapy with psilocybin. So there's a lot to be done in thinking about ways in which psychotherapy can be blended with psychedelics.
Thanks for your questions, everyone, and thanks very much to Paul and Fiona for your participation. Thanks for attending.